This is Midnight in the Desert. I'm Art Bell. And tonight, you better pay particular attention here at the beginning of the program because I'm going to tell you how to call the show and sound good. How's that? There's lots of ways you can sound bad. You can be on a cell phone in Death Valley. You'll really sound bad. Actually, you won't sound anything at all. I don't think. Well, maybe they do have cellular service there. I'm not really sure. At any rate, you get the idea. Lots of ways to sound bad and a few really good ways to sound good. One is to use a connected, real telephone. The second is to use, well, you can use a cell phone. Now, if you've got 5 bars, you know, or you've got lots and lots of bars, well, a cell phone probably is going to be okay. But there is a better way. It's to use Skype. If you've got an Apple product, you know, an iPhone, or you've got an Android lesser phone. Trying to start a fight here, folks. You can add Skype, put Skype on your phone, and then I get that there are two ways to call me. One, you can try to make me a contact, and then that'll put it on your list, and all you got to do is click on it to call me. And I'm about to tell you how to do that. And number two, you can actually just go to the dialing place and put in MITD51 or MITD55 and call me. So either way, put Skype on your phone, for goodness sakes. Then, if you're in North America, U.S., Canada, whatever, call me at MITD51. That's Midnight in the Desert, right? MITD51. Or if you're anywhere outside of North America, call me at MITD55. Midnight in the Desert 55. One more time, MITD55. Very easy way to call. And when you do call that way, boy, you really sound good. We have got the best in digital. And I a lot of people to thank for that. I keep getting emails from people saying, Art, the audio is so clear. Well, thank you, Telos. They provided a very great deal of the really, you know, clear equipment. My friend Joe Talbot here in town. I want to thank Keith Rowland, my webmaster. I do this all up front, you see. Dr. J, my producer, all of you, of course. The Belgab website, you might want to check them out. They're rough but vaguely lovable. I've said that before. Stream Guys and LV.net, they provide the internet that gets us from here to there. All right, tonight is open lines, and that means anything goes. Anything you want to talk about is fair game. Anything at all. Now, I don't care if you're a vampire. Talk to us. In fact, if you're a vampire, definitely talk to us. But what I'm going to really open is a time traveler line tonight. Now, I don't mean members of our time traveler group that get to download the shows. I mean real time travelers. Those of you who are able to travel in time, either to the future or the past. Now, I am going to give you all a special line. Nobody's ever heard of this line before because I've been saving it. This line, if you call it, by the way, you will note you're coming through Roswell, New Mexico, to call me. You dial 1-575. This is only, now listen to me, only time travelers. Only those who have actually traveled in time, not members of the group. 1-575-208-7787. That's area code 575-208-7787. Only if you're a time traveler. Otherwise, the public lines are fine. You're welcome to use those. That would be area code 952-225-5278. That's the public line. 952-225-5278. And again, Roswell, only for time travelers, real time travelers. And I'm not easily fooled. I mean, I'll listen, but, you know, if I catch something really askew, I'm going to say something. See, it's already ringing. Interesting. Okay, so a couple of items I want to run by you. We'll do a break and then come back and open the lines, and God save us all. All right. I've been talking to you about the digital revolution, right? Today the news came out that AT&T is now the owner of DirecTV. Holy moly. DirecTV has purchased, or AT&T has purchased DirecTV. Now, close your eyes, use your imagination, and think, you know, what could AT&T do with DirecTV? DirecTV is a really big company to get swallowed. $48.5 billion, actually. Well, my guess is that a lot of you who are on phones soon are going to be watching DirecTV on your phone. Yeah, I know some of you can already do it, but imagine this merger. Oh, man. The world is changing so fast, and we just barely got on this breaking wave, baby. Conditions on Pluto. Somewhat hazy with flowing ice. Sounds like a weather forecast. Incredibly hazy with flowing ice. Pluto is hazier than scientists expected and now appears to be covered with flowing ice. Oh, man, that's incredible. And then this from theanomalist.com. I want to talk to this guy. It is reported that a Washington state officer, a trooper, says he leaves gifts of food for Bigfoot in a location up in the North Cascade Mountains. He's gotten, he says, within 20 feet of them, heard them speak to each other in what sounds like a mix of Native American and Asian language. The state trooper says he has no intention of obtaining evidence or revealing their location, so it's unclear what his motives are in coming forth with this story. But, Mr. Trooper, I want to talk to you. And I'm sure everybody would like to hear a little bit about that. So, yeah. Please call me, Mr. Trooper, if you're out there. If you're really seeing, you know, this is pretty impressive. A state trooper, right? With Bigfoot. And there's more, but we're going to go to open lines. That's what tonight is. Nothing but open lines. Now, there is the possibility that the gentleman that I judge to be very literate and probably, although I never asked, a member of Anonymous may call in. I gave him the appropriate information to do so, but if he does, you know, he may chicken out too. I don't know. We'll see. What I really wanted to ask was about the philosophy of Anonymous. Now, there is one more thing. My Twitter account. In the second hour of this program, I may open a Periscope. How many of you know what Periscope is? If you go to Periscope and you're connected to my Twitter account, you'll get a notification that I've come up on Periscope. Now, what you're going to be able to see is probably not worth looking at. The back of my head, my equipment, studio, as much as can be picked up by my iPhone 6 camera back there. So in the second hour of the show, I'm probably going to go up on Periscope for at least a little while now. So join me on Twitter. I am ArtBell51. That's ArtBell, ArtBell51. And if I come up then in the second hour or so of the show, you'll be able to see me doing the show. I have no idea of why it's any interest whatsoever, because you're not going to hear much. I guess you'll hear my voice. You'll see little meters moving and things ringing and dials going crazy and all of that, but that's about it. Nevertheless, gazillions of you have asked that they be able to see something, so it is Periscope I will use, and you that will views. Sorry. Again, it's ArtBell51, ArtBell51. little significance there, huh? Okay, so what we're going to do is, I think I've got everything out that I wanted to. We're going to break now, and then when we come back, anything goes. Isn't there a song by that name? And I mean anything. This is Midnight. Now, I believe the gentleman who wrote me the very articulate email about Anonymous, the meme Anonymous, is on the line. Hello there.
Good evening, Mr. Bell.
Good evening, sir. Are you far away from a computer?
I am not, sir.
Okay. We have a little tunnel effect, but actually, you know what? It's perhaps better this way, that your voice is not quite as clear as it might otherwise. All right, look, when you wrote me that, we had a communication, and during that communication, I did not ask you if you were part of Anonymous, and I don't think I'm going to ask you that now unless you want to just cop to it.
The thing about Anonymous is that those who openly profess to be members of Anonymous usually aren't. Anonymous is... The best way I can describe it is Anonymous is a shared pseudonym of a subset of people whose citizenship is the internet. Anybody who has been infected with the Anonymous meme is Anonymous. The only differentiation between an active member of Anonymous and somebody on the net is whether or not they take up the Guy Fawkes mask, say they're Anonymous, and then do something with it.
Okay. All that said, in your own mind, is you or isn't you? And you don't have to answer that. You can say, I'm not going to answer that.
You know, I'm not going to answer that.
Okay, cool. I guess here's where I want to begin with you. I want to understand a little bit about Anonymous. For example, targets. When Anonymous decides to hit a target, generally, would you say that these are people who most of the population would view as not necessarily villainous, but perhaps having done something wrong, having harmed or hurt somebody? Is that the kind of target that you go after?
In the past 5 years, that has largely been the case.
Uh-huh.
Early in the history of the Anonymous meme, that was not the case.
Okay, so... Is there I've listened to a number of messages from Anonymous on the web, and there is a philosophy, and it touches on politics, it touches on the economics of the world, the unfairness going on. Is that fair to say it's all part of what Anonymous is?
It is accurate to say that those are the considered opinions of some Anons who have made it their mission to speak out and occasionally to undertake direct action about those things. There are other Anons who, quite frankly, couldn't care less. And that is entirely their decision, for good, for ill, or for indifferent.
Sure. So it's controlled anarchy? Or uncontrolled anarchy?
I would say barely controlled anarchy.
Barely controlled. Okay.
By and large, Anonymous does... So the thing about anarchy is it doesn't mean there are no rules. It means there are no rulers. And Anonymous does have some rules that most Anons tend to follow.
Right, right.
One of them is... If you openly profess to be Anonymous and you are not Anonymous. Another one is you don't go after the media.
Really? Oh, we are so pleased to hear that one.
Well, we live in a media-saturated culture and a media-saturated world. If it doesn't wind up on the news, it didn't happen. Doesn't matter what it was. Somebody could let off a nuclear device, but if it wasn't on the 6 o'clock news, most people would have no idea.
Boy, are you right about that.
So because of this, the media is probably the greatest weapon that Anonymous has, because power perceived is power achieved. And if you can convince enough people that you wield power, you have that power, and you can do what you like with it.
Yeah. Is this meme growing, in your opinion?
Absolutely. This is in part due to the fact that cadres of Anonymous occasionally hold recruiting drives, or at least I think of them as recruiting drives, where they seek out new members. They hold what amount to boot camps for operational security, privacy, encryption, how to access any of the Anonymous communications networks, how to essentially compartmentalize your life as an Anon from your work life, your home life, your school life, things like that.
Wow.
And also, by utilizing the media as a communications medium and a weapon, the meme is propagated to people who would otherwise probably never have encountered Anonymous before. And some number of people who have learned about Anonymous by watching watching and learning about ops on the news or reading in the paper may have joined.
Mm-hmm. No secret handshakes, right?
No secret handshakes. by and large,
I'm sorry, I had to ask. I'm sorry.
No, it's okay. by and large, you just have to have a pretty thick skin. If you don't, give as well as you get, and generally try to treat other Anons the way you'd want to be treated. Mm-hmm. Of course, there were some Anons who couldn't care less about that, but by and large, Anons in the Anonymous hive mind tend to sink or swim based upon what they accomplish and how many people that they can convince to help them do something.
A lot of people know about the internet, of course. Mm-hmm. A lot of people don't know that there's something deep and dark under what we see as the internet, right?
That is the case.
In fact, so deep and dark that most friends I have, even the pretty, literate computer users, say, for God's sakes, don't go there. I don't know, what do you call it? The internet, the dark net, the devil's nest, what?
It really depends on on which of these networks you mean. The Tor network is often called the dark net.
Right.
But there are other websites that are on the public net which would most certainly fit the description.
Mm-hmm.
The only difference between a hidden computer network and an overt but extremely over the top and frightening website is whether or not you go to it. And there are other sorts of computer networks which could also be said to fit that general description.
Mm-hmm. Like, even if somebody knew how to go to some of the places you described, would it be fair to describe these places for the average computer user as more than a little dangerous?
Define danger, please.
Not being able to use your computer anymore? I don't know.
I need to think about that for a moment. So, for some of these sites,
possibly not caring about your bank balance? I don't know. I'm just trying to present danger here.
Perfectly valid forms of danger. So, I think I should take those in descending order of complexity.
Sure.
For some of the hidden chat servers and websites on the Tor darknet.
Yes.
I have yet to encounter any sites which are specifically booby-trapped to try to compromise the browser's computer. Uh-huh. It doesn't mean they're not out there. It doesn't mean that no one will try it in the future. It means that in the time I've spent exploring them and actually looking for them, I haven't found any. It is more likely that your average casual user would be hit by a compromised website on what we would consider the civilian or the public net, or would be hit by a spear phishing attack, which would redirect them to a compromised site for that specific purpose.
You know, it's true. There's plenty of stuff like that on the regular net, but I would imagine once you get down there, I'm sure somebody like yourself knows how to navigate your way through that, or do you even fear entering that area?
There is always fear. The thing about fear is fear reminds you to be cautious. It That's reminds true. You not to take things at face value, and
true.
It reminds you to trust your intuition. And if your intuition is screaming at you saying, for God's sake, don't go here, there's something wrong,
right.
you should probably listen to it.
And if it says Uncle Carl has left you $45 million, and all... don't go there either.
Yeah, don't go there either.
Okay.
Or if you do, fill in the name and address of Godzilla McMurphy at 123 N.E. Street, Silverdale, California.
That's right. That's right. Is there any reason for the general public to fear Anonymous? Oh, you have to think about it.
Oh, yes. There are individual Anons who may be inclined to make people's lives difficult in the extreme under the aegis of Anonymous.
I see.
In recent years, some of the major data breaches at government agencies, very large corporations, or let's say companies that certainly do not have the best interests of people in general or citizens of the internet in particular at heart, their employees would most certainly be valid targets. One of the things that come to mind are some of the surveillance software companies that were compromised by Anonymous in the past couple of years, where employee records were dumped on the net as a way of shaming the employees for working for companies that sell surveillance hardware and software to whoever can buy it.
All right. Let's see. What else do I want to ask you? What would you want, if you were to describe Anonymous to the general public in at least a fair way, how would you describe it?
I would describe Anonymous as a hive mind, and possibly I would describe it as an emergent phenomenon of the first generation of people who were, for all intents and purposes, born and raised on the internet.
Born and raised on the internet. Yes, very good point. Man, that's really incredible. What a world we live in today. I'm simply amazed. And going back to a very important point that you made, you said Anonymous does not go after the media.
By and large, no, they don't. Because...
I, for one, am so happy to hear that.
The thing about the media is, if you want to get your message out, you have to at least let the media get close enough to you to take notes and come up with a story of some kind.
Well, that's true. I did make an appeal on Twitter, and boy, I did get a big response. Not at first, but pretty big response. So I'm impressed. You saw it, did you? Yes.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that we are being monitored right now? In other words, do you think NSA or whoever monitors this kind of thing is trying to figure out who you are and where you are and what you're up to?
I have no doubt at all. And by the way, hello everyone at Fort Meade.
Yeah, I'm sure they're listening. I'm not going to hold this very long. I would like to make you my, I don't know, official information source for Anonymous. I wonder if that's fair. Do you mind being an official information source?
I wouldn't say I'm official, but if I can help somehow, I'd like to.
Okay, how about unofficial information source?
That's fair.
All right. I will call upon you in the future, as the Godfather said. Listen, brother, thank you very, very much. I've always wanted to speak with somebody like yourself. Take care and good luck. I hope the door stays closed and all of that stuff. Thank you very, very much. I think it took a lot of guts to do what that man just did. So thank you, buddy. Godfather, actually. All right. So open lines. Anything you want to talk about. Again, if you are a time traveler, that means if you actually traveled in time to the past and or the future, especially if you did so mechanically, I'm giving you our special Roswell line for time travelers only. Area code 575-208-7787. Whew, got to get that right. 575-208-7787. Of course, you have to put one in front of that, right? All right, here we go. Open lines, anything goes. Let's try Skype and Larry.
Hello, Art. AL0AA from Prescott, Arizona.
Well, okay. Prescott, anyway, Arizona. Yes.
I have a couple suggestions.
That's a ham radio call, by the way, everybody.
Yeah, that's a ham call. If you can have Chuck Messler or Hal Lindsey on again, I heard them in your other venue, and when you broadcasted from the Philippines, I was listening.
Mm-hmm.
And if you could talk more about your cats and your wife and child.
Sure.
I think I heard you had more daughters. I think your listeners would love to hear it.
All right.
And I'm really glad you're back on the air.
Thank you.
This is great, and I think Skype is great.
Thank you.
And thank you for the privilege.
All right, my friend. Take care. And
you too.
And thank you for calling. 73. So, the girls are great. My wife, Erin, is extremely supportive. And we've been married a while now. Quite a while. And we have an 8-year-old daughter who is named Asia, and she is a straight-A student. Yeah, I can brag about her a little bit, right? She's a straight-A student. The, the sad news is we lost Yeti. Yeti was our alpha cat, and after 23 years, he was getting so sick, I realized that I was keeping him alive more for me than, for him. So at that point, I said, that's enough, and anyway, I don't want to talk a lot about this because it'll put me in a bad mood, and I want to be in a good mood tonight. Abby is now taking over the position of alpha cat. Now, that is really interesting. Abby, who is, like number two, it's unbelievable. Abby has completely changed. It's kind of like he went from kitty to tiger. In other words, he's taken the alpha position, and poor little Dolly, well, she's the only slave around. So anyway, the Bell household is just spiffy. Let's go here, I think, somewhere outside the country and say, hello, you're on Midnight.
Hello?
Hello. Now you're shuffling all around. You just need to get close to whatever the microphone is and talk into that.
Do you hear me now?
No. Talk. What are you trying to talk into?
I have headphones. And a microphone and a headphone.
No, your microphone is not active. So since that's...
Do you hear me now?
Oh, yes, much better. Where are you?
I am in Chile, in South America.
Wow! Really? you are my first South American call.
Really? That's nice.
So you're in Chile?
Yeah, I'm in Chile, in the city of La Serena.
Wow. Well, welcome to the program. That's really exciting. It really is.
Oh, thank
exciting.
You, Art.
Uh-huh.
I've listened to your shows since about 2 years. I've listened to some of the old Coast to Coast, and I've been listening to all your shows for about that time. And it's really exciting to me to have come through.
I know. It's exciting to have you come through. What is your favorite topic that we have talked about?
My favorite topic is secret societies and more of the conspiracy world. I have listened to.
I've got a question for you already. If you like secret societies, yeah, we talk a lot about ours here. But I'm curious, do you have secret societies in Chile?
Well, all the typical secret societies. Chile was founded by a Masonic lodge. Our founding fathers were all Masons, and as in almost every South American country back in the 19th century. So there has been a Masonic presence in Chile, very strong. There's also, I know that the OTO even is here, has a lodge in Santiago, in the capital city.
Mm-hmm.
I think Chile has a very long story for the secret societies also, but those would be the most notorious, the Masonic lodges here. Are very strong.
Is Chile pretty stable now?
Yeah, it's pretty stable. It's pretty stable. We have been growing in the past years, but now all is very stuck, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But it seems that the whole world is getting stuck right now.
Oh yes. Well, I have lived in third world countries, and there are days when you wake up and find out that tanks are in the street and there's a military coup underway. So I've been there and done that.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. But here the thing is. It's very stable. It's more stable than other countries of South America.
All right. All right. Well, listen, I've got to go, but I really appreciate your call, and you can keep the honor with you that you were the first call ever from Chile.
Oh, that's a great honor, Art. Thank you very much, and all the best to you and your show.
Thank you. The way he did that was to simply dial MITD. 55 MITD 55. And again, let me give out the time traveler line. Come on, time travelers. I know you're out there. Area code 575-208-7787. And if we can't find time travelers, it's quite all right. We'll settle for people who think they were the Antichrist. Perhaps those who have seen an entity, an alien line. Men in Black, Abduction Line, Immortals. You know, I mean, we're open to, as you can see, virtually anything. Who is Dobie? Dobie, welcome to Midnight.
Hello, Art.
Okay, I'm good, but you're far away from your computer, and it sounds terrible.
Yes.
Oh, God. Yeah, get close to the microphone on your computer. Can you do that?
Yeah, how's that?
Closer.
My headset is not working. Damn it.
I see. Yeah. I think it's the same problem the first caller had.
Yeah. I'll call back, man.
Oh, no, it's okay.
All right, I wanted to find out what's going on with Mel's hole. Have you heard about that guy?
Well, I presume the hole's still there. Oh, you mean Mel?
Yeah.
Okay, so the word was that Mel contracted cancer, I believe, and went to Australia. Now, I've not heard anything since, but I'm open to hearing. Okay? So, if Mel's out there, buddy, call me. All right?
Yeah. Whenever I want to tell somebody about your show, I explain the sheep story.
whatever gets the promo done. On my time traveler line, you are on the air.
Hello, Mr. Bell.
Yes, sir. Welcome to the program.
How are you doing?
I'm doing all right.
It's been a while.
Glad
to hear you back.
You are a time traveler?
Yes. I'm not sure if I should give you my real name or not.
No, I wouldn't do that.
No.
I wouldn't do that.
Call me John is the most common name in America, or one of the most common. So you could call me that for point of reference.
You don't have anything to do with somebody named Cheater, do you?
No.
Okay. So your name is John. John,
yeah.
How have you traveled in time? Have you gone to the future, the past, or both?
Well, you see, Mr. Bell, I was born in the future. My year was 2078.
2078.
Not so distant future. 2078.
Can you tell me, if I ask you a question or two about 2078, can is that all right?
No, perfectly fine. Okay. Well, you see, I can answer to best of my abilities because I was born in 2078.
Of course,
but
yeah.
The Time Traveling Agency, they bring us back.
Agency?
My family was part of an experiment to where I was born in 2078, but we move back in time every 5 years.
Oh.
So right now I'm in 2034. And I could tell you this much, Art, gas prices are still the same.
Is that right? We must have really gotten Iraq straightened out, huh?
No. The Middle East is a mess.
Still a mess.
There's no ISIS. I could tell you this much. There's no ISIS, but there's far, far worse.
Far worse than ISIS?
Yeah.
I don't even know if I want to know about that. You know what I do want to know? What is the current iPhone model?
We are up to the iPhone 34GS.
34GS. I hate those middle models. I hate the middle models, but I can only imagine what it does. Holy mackerel.
Oh, Art, you should see it now. They're getting bigger and bigger and thicker and thicker. It's like
what?
It's like the giant cinder block phone is coming back in style for some reason in the future.
Oh no!
Yes, my time traveling cat is next to me. By the way, no, he was born in this year. But what I wanted to say was the Android and the Samsung phones are obsolete. I think they went 10 years ago.
I knew it. The Android was going to go obsolete. I knew it.
Absolutely.
I'm sorry. And, I whoop it up a little.
As a time traveler, can I make a request also for something I would love for you to talk about?
You may. Yes, you may.
You had this gentleman on, which was a great interview, talking about the internet and Anonymous.
Oh, yes.
And all I got is two words for you, Art. Two words. And this, to me, is... It's the kicker, and it's still alive and rampant here in the future.
Uh-huh.
The dark web.
Yeah.
The dark web online, which is, I'm not sure if you know about the dark web or not.
I presume the internet is still alive and well.
Yes.
Good.
But the dark web in your time is, you can't access it only by proxy.
If you want to live.
Oh, yes. Mankind, as we all know, there's some dark, evil people in mankind. And the dark web, you have to access by proxy. And a few years back in the year 2011, there was a website called the Silk Road. Do you remember that?
I heard of the Silk Road, yes.
Yes. And that is one example of the dark web. Basically, the dregs of society using the internet for every wrong reason. And
very dangerous.
Deepest, darkest things you can imagine on the internet.
You said you're now in 2034, is that correct?
Yeah.
So in 2034, I would imagine the internet is still alive and really well.
It's, guess what, the cable companies, they've been busted on their head because of streaming. So the internet is really well. I think that's the only thing that's pretty much advanced. We don't have any flying cars. We still have bottled water.
What? No flying cars?
No.
You know, that is such a busted promise to humanity.
But Crystal Pepsi is back.
Crystal? Really? I have a friend who'll be really hot to hear about that. He's a Pepsi nut.
And yes. I'm not sure about interdimensions or anything like that, but the furthest we have gone in the future... was actually to 2091.
Is there anything memorable from 2091 that you could tell us about?
I got one thing.
Yes.
Water cars. Cars that are running on water.
You know, it might happen. It really might happen. All right, my friend, I thank you for the call.
I got one more.
Yeah,
one more thing. Art Bell, Mr. Art Bell, is a legend in all of these years. And nobody, in the future, everybody has forgotten about that other show. And they worship you as the king of late night radio. So from the future, take care, my friend.
All right, thank you very much. Yeah, well. You know, I do have one thing to say. Apparently, some of you have been going over to the other's website and writing things and getting banned. Don't do that. It's not necessary. I thank you for the feelings that, you know, I began to see on my Facebook today that people were saying they were getting banned from that other place. So, you know, it's not worth it. That's all right. Let's go somewhere, I think, outside the country. Say hello. You are on Midnight.
Hi, Art. How are you?
Oh, it's Jazz.
Hey, Art. How are you going?
I'm going quite well. How are you, Jazz?
Fantastic.
Now, this, everybody, you should know who you're listening to. This is Jazz Munda. He is the guy who produced most of, and that's a fair comment, most of the incredible trailers that, I don't know, it's like, I guess it's like somebody who, I looked at him and I said, this has got to be a guy from, you know, a movie company. I mean, you do work in the industry, right?
No, not at all. I'm just a very big fan of yours, Art, and it was just a thank you to you and for the 20 years of entertainment you have given us.
Jazz, how do you do it? How do you do it?
I don't know. It's just a hidden talent, I guess.
You answer like the guy from maybe Anonymous, excuse me. So really, how do you do it? I mean, there must be... When I look at those things, I think, no, this is, it looks like something I just saw for a recent movie promotion, so there's got to be a secret to it. What software do you use?
I was just using iMovie on my Mac. I listened to a lot of classic shows of yours. I found the appropriate images to go along with it, and I just put it together.
Well, all I can say is, thank you, buddy. They were over the top cool.
Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate all right. that.
So now that we have open lines, what is on your Aussie mind?
So I have a little story for you about one of your favorite topics, and that is red eyes.
Well,
I know how much you love red eyes.
Yeah, don't call it a favorite topic. It's I really don't like red eyes. Glowing red eyes are creepy. Anyway, go ahead.
A few weeks ago, my daughter came running into my bedroom in the middle of the night, and she was screaming that there was a monster in her room. So, you know, I bolt upright in the bed, and I try to calm her down, and I try to usher her back to her room. And when we're on the way down the hall, she sort of says to me, the monster had red eyes. And Art, I stopped dead in my tracks because I graduated from the Art Bell School of the Paranormal, so I know that red eyes are bad news. And I didn't want to shatter any illusions that my daughter might have that I'm some indestructible superhero, so I bravely soldier on and continue on to her bedroom. So I open the door, I enter the pitch-dark room, and as I gaze towards the closets, I think I actually let out an audible yelp, and my heart just absolutely sank because staring across at the other end of the room were two little red eyes.
Oh, God.
And, Art, if I wasn't frozen in place with fear, I would have turned tail and bolted and left my daughter for dead to fend for herself. But then I realized that we didn't have an encounter with a red-eyed monster. And fortunately for my daughter and I, the red eyes belonged to the little oil heater that we had bought for her the week before. So, look, I might not have actually had the experience of having a red-eyed monster, but I certainly got the fright and the fear that would come along with an encounter such as that. So.
The part that got me is you might have run and left your daughter for dead. Five. In the meantime, let's try again. Pretty good luck so far, actually. On the time traveler line, routed through Roswell, New Mexico, I might add. This is Midnight, and you're on. You should be on. Now you're on. Hello.
Hello, Art. My name is Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith. How original.
I know.
That's fine. I will accept that, Mr. Smith. You really are a time traveler?
Yes, sir. 2085.
2085. You could sort of sympathize then with some of the stuff that the guy from 2091 said.
No, different timeline.
Oh. Also, no, in other words, you don't just travel in time, but a different timeline.
Yes, sir.
That's really something. Okay. So what can you tell me about 2085? I mean, people want to know. I want to know.
Well, it's not good. The UN has, because of a population disappearance of 3%, the UN has started a census program, and all members of the UN have to be tagged.
All members of the UN have to be tagged? You mean like all birds get tagged?
Member states.
Member states. Oof. And 3% of the population disappears?
Yes.
Are you talking about, for example, 3% of the totality of the number in 2015 are gone by your year?
Yes.
Can you tell me why? What happened?
No one knows.
Well, that's an interesting answer. Nobody knows.
They're still trying to figure out, but in the meantime, all the countries organized under the United Nations to try to get things organized, but it's turned into a fascist state.
You mean the United Nations is fascist?
Yeah.
I've never much liked them, and a lot of people in the U.S. have never much liked them, so... and they never, frankly, had much power back here in 2015, so you're telling me by 2085, the United Nations has pulled it together, sort of, and now is powerful?
Yes, because of the disappearances. What world is in chaos?
Are you suggesting that the United Nations is responsible for the disappearances?
Some think they are. Some think it's extraterrestrial. They just don't know.
Figures try to blame it on the ETs. In the year 2085, have we yet established contact with ETs?
There was a radio signal confirmed, but nothing since the radio signal just before the disappearances.
That's kind of depressing. We had the WOW signal, and you're saying there was a radio signal. Was it actually verified as being ET?
Not that signal. There was a one around 2075.
2075. Man, that's a long wait. Okay, is there any downside to traveling in time? I mean, for example, I would like to ask, you got to 2085, but from what year?
I am from 2085.
Oh, so, but you said you're a time traveler.
Yes.
So, yeah, I understand you're in 2085 at the moment, but...
No, here.
I beg your pardon?
2015 here now.
2015, yes. So you're back here, what, slumming?
No, to organize resistance against the United Nations to with the list of people that we know are still there.
So you literally need an army to fight the UN.
Yeah, their past relative, you know, the set up supplies and stuff like that.
Right. So what happened to individual nation sovereignty, if I can ask?
There was a world crisis.
And the UN used that crisis to sort of take charge?
Yes.
Wow. Okay. You're giving me some information that is surprising me. Can I ask you by what method you're able to travel in time?
No, I can't.
You can't. Okay, no. Is there anything else that you really want to get...
I can't tell you. It is mechanical, not physical or spiritual or anything like that.
All right, if you were to describe the method, the mechanical method you use to travel in time, would that be a problem? In other words, would you cause some kind of ripple that would... I don't know what it would do, frankly.
To tell you the truth, I'm not a scientist.
All right. You're more of a soldier.
Not a soldier per se. What?
How about a recruiter?
The militias of today would be more like it.
Militias of today. All right. Well, thank you very, very much for the call. Think about that. Imagine that. At least he's innovative. Now, you know, we have no way of knowing if he's really a time traveler, but he could be. He very well could be. It could be there's lots of time travelers out there. So when people make these claims, and, you know, he sounded at least serious, that's plausible. I mean, don't governments always use crisis to take charge? When there's some great crisis, suddenly there is what? Some kind of martial law, some sort of somebody to take charge. So if the world really got out of control, I suppose the UN could make its bid, right? It's definitely a possibility. Let's try Skype. Sean, you're on Midnight.
Oh, wow. Hi, Art. Thank you for having me on the show.
Sure thing.
And, yeah, this is actually a very interesting program. I remember listening to you on the other network years and years ago. In fact, I might, keyword being might, if I can ever go through my mini disc collection, be able to find a snippet of a program I have on mini disc.
You have to say it a certain way if you're going to say it. You say the other network.
Yes, the other network. Or to make it a little bit more effective, the other network.
Oh, man, that knocked me back in my seat.
Yes, I have a reverb control. I'm not afraid to use it. But anyway, yes, I will say, though, speaking of all this time travel stuff, it's interesting stuff to me because I am not a time traveler. At least I don't think I am so far as I know.
So I'm upset that, you know what upset me so far?
What?
Phones getting thicker.
Yeah, personally, I think the first guy, I don't think, we are not going to see phones getting thicker so far as I can tell. I don't think that's going to happen.
Well, people always say that, right? It's never going to happen. People make predictions. We're going to have flying cars. You heard what he said about that.
Right.
That's still a broken promise.
Well, I think of it this way. If you follow Doctor Who at all,
mm-hmm.
There's a quote from Doctor Who that I actually think applies incredibly well to stuff when you're dealing with time, and that is, and I'm probably going to butcher it horribly, so my apologies to any Whovians that are listening. Time may appear to be a linear progression of cause and effect, but when viewed from a non-linear perspective, it's really just a big ball of wibbly-wobbly, timey-wimey stuff.
Timey-wimey stuff.
Yeah.
And how long did that take you to cook up, timey-wimey stuff?
Yeah. that was whoever invented the quote. I will not take credit for that. That is whoever threw that quote out there in Doctor Who land.
You know, so obviously I'm having some fun with all this, but I actually think there are time travelers out there.
I'm not saying there aren't. I'm also saying, like, I don't know. See, the thing about me is I have had weird experiences involving time, mm-hmm. You know?
Yes.
Weird experiences. And I don't know how I do this. I'm going to try to keep this as brief as I can, and I'm apologizing if I'm not able to. I have, since about, I don't know, a certain number of years ago, as I don't really want to give my age out or anything.
That's fine.
I have had instances where I will go to sleep, I'll wake up, and then I'll drift off to sleep, and I'll hit a certain state somehow, that it's like I'm half asleep, I'm half awake, or something. I don't really know how to explain this, but in that state, I've been able to catch glimpses of future events.
Oh.
Events specifically, like, regarding me, but it's nothing actually useful.
Well, I don't care, useful or not, are they events that come true?
They usually are, but here's the weird thing. If I try to actually think about them and decode them consciously,
yes,
they break. It's a bit like playing with string.
What do you mean they
really
break?
Like, for example, a good example of this is actually, like, for example, if I have a vision, let's say, of somebody saying something about their father was being, you know, a not so good person that day or something.
Right.
And I think, oh, well, I'm going to have that happen at my school. And in reality, I was reading something online and the thing happened at home. You know, so it's sort of like I tried to think of, like, oh, when is this going to happen?
Right. Well, that's, you know, that's, listen, thank you for the call. That's really just precognition. And it's real. I've had this, I had a precognition experience. And I've got to tell you, there was no question about it. I mean, it wasn't, you know, maybe this happened or anything like that. This was like a brick hitting your head. Now, see, I've got to tell it. I'll tell it very quickly. I was living at the time in Santa Barbara. I'm sure many of you have heard this, so I'm sorry. Sitting, I came home from work, working, of course, at a radio station in Santa Barbara. I had a little garden apartment with a sliding door, you know, that looked outside, and I parked my car outside the apartment on the street. And I sat down to watch the evening news. I've always been and still am a news junkie. The news came on, and suddenly, and by the way, the curtains were closed, the door was closed. Suddenly, an overwhelming thing hit me, like a wave breaking over me. Your car's going to get hit. Your car is in trouble. Your car's going to get hit. So I said a bad word, and I got up, and let me answer this one and keep you on hold there. If you hear audio, that means you're going to be getting on the air, so hang in there. I went over to the window, opened the curtain, looked out, saw my car. It was fine. I said another bad word, closed the curtain, went back, sat down, watched the news. Well, here comes a wave again. You're going to get hit. Your car's going to get hit. Your car's going to get hit. Said another bad word. I do say them, by the way. Got back up, went over, opened the curtains, this time opened the door, and stood there and watched my car, which, by the way, I cared a lot about. As I watched my car, a guy came down, went down the sidewalk from our building toward my car, didn't get in my car, got in his car, which was in front of it, backed up and hit my car while I watched. Let me tell you, it freaked me out so badly, I fell to my knees, but had enough, got myself going quick enough to get up and say, hey, I saw that. He said, I'm stopping. But I mean, this was not a maybe, it was a warning. This was ignore it and you die kind of warning. So these precognitive things are indeed possible. All right, let's go back to the lines. On my time traveler line through Roswell, New Mexico, you are on Midnight.
Oh, how awesome is this? Hello, Arts.
Pretty awesome, actually. Hi there.
Oh. Hi. I go by Wise Frog online, but my name is Paul, and presently I'm in Ohio.
Okay, Paul.
And, yes, I'm a time traveler. I don't need a device to go anywhere.
You can do this how?
I do this basically at will. As I've stated before on different radio shows, all you need to do is just make a doorway using whatever your athame or whatever projected device that you can use. You step into the moment, and then you step out wherever it is that you want to go.
Very cool. So you can you can project yourself, I assume, into the past or the future?
I can go into the past and the future. I can take anything I want with me. Usually I use my motorcycle.
Mm-hmm.
I can have anybody with me that I want. Most people are too scared to do this. But I've got a few people that do go from time to time with me to places like the Civil War.
The Civil War.
Like the 2036, 2034.
Wow. All right, Paul. A number of questions come to mind. And the first is, if you're really able to do this, is there any danger in it?
Yeah. For example, if I'm on my motorcycle and I need to know the terrain.
Oh, yeah.
Back or in the, you know, in the future or in the present or in the past, I need to know the terrain because, like, for example, in Toledo, Ohio, we've got the Erie Canal. And if I'm, on the Anthony Wayne Trail, if I'm going down the Anthony Wayne Trail, and I go 150 years in the past, well, the Anthony Wayne Trail was the Erie Canal.
You're not telling me you get up the cojones to actually shift in time while you're riding your motorcycle. Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
You're out of your time traveling mind.
I've done it with people on the back of my bike.
My God, that's dangerous.
It's fun.
Well, I asked you if there was danger. I mean, you've cooked up your own danger. You do that, and you're liable to end up in the water. You're liable to end up in the middle of a building or, God, anything, but a tree.
I could wrap around anything. Yeah. So you do need to be careful.
Well, heck yeah. All right, tell me something about either the past or the future that is interesting.
Well, one of the times that I went back into the Civil War, I ended up down south. I was in Mississippi. I was down there for like 3 weeks. I had taken a girl down there with me, and we played the whole Doctor Who scenario because that was like really fun, but people thought we were out of our minds, but they believed it because I had a motorcycle. Well, that motorcycle, I ended up burning the plugs out because I was using moonshine to run my bike. They melted my bike down for metal so that they would have guns. They didn't care. They just melted the bike down.
So they turned your bike. They turned your bike into guns.
They turned my bike into guns.
All right. Well, that's different than plowshares, I guess. Paul, you're not the guy who's got the picture of himself back in the Civil War, are you? Or are you?
Art, I couldn't tell you about Civil War.
There is. No. Well, I'm telling you, there is a guy who claims he's a time traveler. And he claims he's actually got a picture of himself in the Civil War. Of course, you know, at that time he's a kid. So
yeah, and I think, well, one of the things when you go back to the Civil War is that if you don't understand how people are talking back then,
yes,
then they're sure not going to understand you.
Got it.
Because you need to speak the same way. And for a little kid to suddenly get thrown into something like the Civil War, he's not going to understand anything that's going on. People are going to think he's crazy, that they're disrespectful.
Mm. Oh, yeah.
And they're just going to shoo the boy on his way.
Did you have a favored side in the war?
No, I didn't. I tried to stay as neutral as I could.
Probably a good idea.
Well, I would end up getting myself shot.
You don't know anything about cell phones getting thicker in the future, do you?
Cell phones don't get thicker in the future. Cell phones become, basically they're more like implants.
Oh, well, we have quite a disparity here between yourself and the other claimed time traveler.
I heard. But Art, you know what? I can prove this. And I can prove it with anybody. If you wanted to get on the back of my bike, I know you wouldn't. I'd get a sidecar. We'll do it in a car. I'd do it with you in a car.
Well, a car is a little bit safer, but, I mean, even then, somebody could have dug a giant hole and...
Well, we could just be walking...
You're not getting on your bike, I'll tell you that.
Down the street.
Yeah, I'm not getting on your bike. No way.
Okay, it's fine.
All right, so I'll tell you what. You contact me privately. Email, something like that, okay? And if you really can do what you say, we'll take a ride.
Want to take a ride?
Yes, indeed. Oswell, the number to call if you're a real-time traveler, 575-208-7787, 575-208-7787. And if you're overseas, all you've got to do is Skype us, MITD55. MITD55. Let's go to Wayne, Michigan, and say, yo, you're on the air, midnight.
Oh, what a pleasure. Mike from Michigan.
Yes, welcome.
Oh, what a... it's great that you're back for number one. And
thank
number
you.
Two, I was going to see if... Are you familiar with John D. Wells?
Oh, yes, of course.
Oh, great, great. Is there any chance that we may get an interview in the future with you and Mr. Wells?
I don't know. Anything could happen, I guess. John's a good guy, and he, too, is an alumni, so to speak.
Well, he speaks very highly of you. I'm a member of his program, and I will soon be a member of your program also.
Well, thank you. Yes, I think very highly of John as well. And as I mentioned, we're both alumni. So, yeah, there you are.
I have a question. You know, you've started so many of these radio programs that I listen to. It's amazing. What happened with the whole Sirius, the XM? And you were on, and then you were off, and then
yes.
The radio.
Yes. All right.
Talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, I will talk about that. Thank you, and thank you for calling. Okay, so yeah, I'll try to make it quick and simple. It's not quick and simple at all. But basically, when I went there, they said, "Well, we have international coverage," and of course, they don't really. If you have a credit card and a U.S. address, you can probably get in from some other country. Otherwise, no. So that wasn't so. And then what really did it was they had trouble with their streaming. And so many of my people were coming from the broadcast world that they subscribed to the streaming service. And the streaming service was, even they acknowledged, having some difficulty. And people were getting cut off and all kinds of stuff was going on. And so I said, this isn't working for me because my people are coming from broadcast and they went to the streaming. It's not working. Or it's not working well. So it came down to an ultimatum. That's when I said, I'm all in. And I said, look, allow us to stream for free only until you fix it. When you fix it, then we're right back where we started from, as Miss Nightingale would say. But they said no. They said no. And that's how we broke up. So I hope that fills it in for some of you out there. We're very short on time, but in Phoenix, Arizona, you're on Midnight. Hi.
Good evening. This is John. I'm actually in Eatonville, Washington.
Really? Okay. Extinguish your device.
Just did, sir.
Excellent. Proceed.
Want to take a ride?
Oh, yeah, baby. We're on a ride, all right.
All right. I got one story for you. I was driving home from work down to Phoenix, Arizona.
Yes.
I'm in a conversion van and decided to call my wife at home.
Yes.
And just, you know, touch base before getting there. Uh-huh. And I started smelling pickles in the whole van. It smelled like vinegar, smelled like pickles, and it was just inundating.
Really?
So, yeah. So I'm talking to my wife on the phone, and I tell her. And she says, you're not going to believe this, but I just dropped a 1 gallon glass jar of pickles from Costco in the kitchen.
Yeah, well, that would do it. So nothing paranormal about that.
Nothing. All right, so that's just connected. Anyway, it's great to have you. I'm one of those people that love to hear you on the radio. I've been listening forever, and you've captured it, man. You're riding the wave. You've conquered it. It's good to hear it.
Thank you, buddy. Take care. I got to go. We're on break. Bye-bye. And maybe, let me do a refresh. I've asked somebody to go up there and tell me, oh, I'm live on Periscope. Thank you very much. Cold War said, Dave said, Glenn said, Han said, Marlene said. Oh, a lot of people said. Well, they're looking at me. And so, that's weird. It is kind of creepy. Let's go to, I don't know, let's go overseas somewhere and say, Jeff, wherever you are, you're on Midnight.
Hey, Art Bell, how you doing, man?
I'm doing okay. Where are you?
Well, actually, I'm in Dallas, Texas.
Oh, man, you're on the wrong line.
Oh, man.
I'm sorry.
Can you still talk to me?
Yeah, no, I can't. That's against the rules. I'm sorry. Xavier, you're on Midnight. Hello?
Art.
Yes.
It's great to hear you, sir. Welcome back to the airwaves.
You. Extinguish your device, please.
And that is done.
All right. Where are you?
I am in Florida, sir.
Oh, Xavier.
Well, I'm sorry. Did I trick the system?
Yeah, you did. It's for overseas only.
For tricking the system.
Okay, well, you didn't trick it because I can't hold on to you. I'm sorry. You're going to have to call the North American line, as did Donna. And let me see if I can get Donna on. Donna, hi.
Hello, Art.
Hey.
Long time no talk to you.
I'm very glad you called. Where are you?
I'm in Arizona, about 2 miles north of the Mexican border.
Oh, okay. You could have almost used my international. Anyway.
Yeah, but I wouldn't do that to you. I'm going to take you back in time. I'm not going to time travel.
Okay.
In 1986, in October 31st, I called in to you and related a ghost story.
Oh. Okay, well, that doesn't resonate yet. Of course, I have many ghost stories, right?
Right. But I used to live in a small town called Fowler, California, home of the Dancing Raisins.
The Dancing Raisins?
And we discussed the fact that there was a certain president that hated the little dancing raisins.
You know, there's also people who hate the screaming lady. Do you know who I'm talking about?
Yes.
Anyway, dancing raisins. Go ahead.
Right. But I told you a story about Lost Lake, which is just outside of Fresno, California.
Okay.
And there was a ghost story about some woman had drowned in the lake, and if you pulled your car too close to the lake, she would come up and scratch on the back of your car, which as a teenager we thought was funny.
Really?
Until it happened to us.
Exactly. Yeah, that kind of thing is really funny, I guess, if you're watching it happen to somebody else, but if it happens to you, it's like the screaming lady.
Yeah, there was a lot of screaming people in the car.
I'm sure. So she scratched. Did she get in?
No, she didn't get in, but she left marks on the back of the car.
What?
Which we had to explain to the young man's parents.
I bet that went well.
Yeah, they said, oh, no, you guys scratched it, so we're going to make all of you pay for it.
Probably said more than that. Probably said, what were you doing parked in the first place?
Well, yeah, that was everyone's parents' question.
Yeah, that's right. It's beginning to be mine, and my daughter's only 8.
There you go. You have a lot more to look forward to when she hits the teenage years.
Oh, course. I know, and she is so pretty. How am I ever going to... Anyway, is that the end of the story, that you had to explain the scratches and then pay?
Well, I didn't have to pay, but the guys had to pay.
It's always better. How come it works that way? How come the guys always have to pay?
You're usually the ones with jobs.
Well, it used to be that way, but now we live in this age of equality. In paying, too.
Well, but you guys always make more money.
Well, see, that may not be true anymore. Honestly,
well, it's starting to
Donna,
change.
In our day when we were young, yeah, true. But today, I'm telling you, there's a lot of gals that make way more than guys.
Yeah, that's true. Mm-hmm. That's very true.
All right. Well, Donna, thank you very, very much for the call. It was a pleasure. And take care. All right. Remember, MITD55 is for overseas. Let's go to British Columbia. You are on the air. It's midnight. Hi.
Hi, Art.
Hello. Extinguish device, please.
Done.
I still hear it.
David, I got it off.
Okay, David.
I'm watching you on Periscope right now.
Are you?
Yep. I saw you waving. I'm calling from Nanaimo, British Columbia, Canada.
Yes.
Very, very happy to see you back on the air, Art.
Well, thank you. You know what? I can probably make it look better in here. Let me turn out this light and then increase my backlight, if I know anything about photography, and I don't know much. Now, I have changed that. Does that sort of change the view a little bit?
You know, what's odd is you're delayed on there. You're delayed more online. Like, I am a time traveler as far as being subscribed to your show.
Right.
When I'm listening to your show, you're delayed more than Periscope, but you are delayed on Periscope as well, but not too much. Actually, you look better with the light off. It just turned off now.
Okay, that's what I was asking. I know with photography, generally you want backlight, right?
Yeah, no, that looks better just like that.
Okay, cool. Anyway, yeah. What is on your mind?
Art, are you going to have a weekend host? We'd love to see you bring George Knapp aboard.
Well, we're going to have weekend shows. Now, you know where George is, right? And George, you know, has a really big job with Channel 8 in Las Vegas, and he really can't do any more. So I think the odds are pretty much against it, much as even I love George Knapp, so, well, love is a strong word. I respect George Knapp, and I'd love to have him here. So, George, if you're listening and you want to come, invite's open, buddy.
Awesome, awesome. Hey, I was on your last show. I was called for the Ghost to Ghost show, and I was called away, and my wife was trying to get a hold of me, and my cell phone was ringing, and I was in a place that I couldn't go. I sure hope that you're going to do Ghost to Ghost again this year.
We're going to do, now listen to me, we're going to Ghost Digital. Ghost to Ghost awesome. Digital.
Well, I will be submitting my story again, definitely.
All right. I will be listening, definitely.
Great.
Thank you very, very much for the call. Take care. And what I'm going to do, I hardly know what I'm doing, is go to my time traveler line and say you're on Midnight. Hello. Hello? Going once.
Hello?
Yes.
Hello.
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 Yes.
You want a kiss? What?
This
Let's
is
go.
Theodore?
Speak.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, hello. Is this
what,
Art Bell?
What? Yes.
Oh, my God, Art Bell.
Yes.
I'm a time traveler. I came back just to hear you. I got through. Well, this device here, I mean, this device not working right. It's to calibrate for the portal around the planet.
I
allow
see.
Me to walk through.
All right, so you really are. You're a time traveler, right?
Yeah, I need to make sure. What time is it?
It's 10:46 and 44 seconds, Mark.
What year, though?
2015.
I just came from the year 3126. I'm totally lost.
3126
right now.
God, 3126, that's way out there. What can you tell me about 3126, please?
Well, there's a lot of land.
A lot of
land. There's not many buildings anymore. We live underground.
Oh, that's not good at all. Why do you live underground, pray tell?
Radiation. The sun has moved too close to the planet.
I'm vaguely familiar with the planetary mechanics, and I don't know how the sun could move. I know that NASA has been talking about moving the Earth further away from the sun for global cooling to take place. But,
well, I'm no scientist on that, but like, I guess the planets has moved closer to the sun, or the other way around. It's confusing.
It would be.
The science here is so far advanced.
Uh-huh.
I guess, like.
Well,
I,
if you,
I don't
if
know much.
Well, we already listen. In 2015, we've already got trouble with global warming.
2015, where you're at? No kidding.
Yeah, we've got a lot of trouble with global warming.
I can't stay here long.
Okay. So I'm getting some weird echo. So what else can you tell me important about 3126?
3126? Well, the subterranean tunnels throughout the planet have begun to collapse.
That's bad.
And we're looking for other destinations across the world to advance our civilization.
I see. So if you live underground, tunnels would be really important for getting to, you know, from point A to point B, yes?
Yes, exactly, yeah. Exactly. And the
sounds
the
like a
travel,
very, very...
transportation.
Yeah, it sounds, we're having a little problem here. It sounds like a terrible, terrible future. I'm concerned.
My time is almost up. The portal's opening again, and I have to go through, or I'll be stuck here.
All right, well, you don't want that. Thank you very much for the call. Can you imagine a future, can you, where the world has become so dangerous in some way, or the planetary alignments have become, as he suggested, so close that we have to go underground? That's not a future I would look forward to at all. Okay, if you're outside the country, MITD 55, and that means outside North America, okay? Outside North America only, MITD 55. Scott on Skype, you're on Midnight. Hello, Scott. Going once for Scott. Gee, you tried so hard to get through. I really hate to see people not make it. Let's try Ray. Hello, Ray on Skype. You're on the air.
Hey, Art. It's a pleasure to finally talk to you.
Well, thank you.
I just want to say from Oregon, a big fan and good friend of mine, Chad, who's also a big fan, we're very happy to have you back on the air.
It's great to be here. Are you, where in Oregon are you?
Eugene, actually.
Eugene. So can you can you hear the mighty KXL out of Portland?
No, I don't, but again, my buddy Chad, he is actually in Portland.
Okay, well, then he's listening to you right now, no doubt.
I'm sure he is.
So what's up?
So I have a couple things for you. I have a story of precognition that I'd like to share and a wish list for the show, if you may.
All right, fire away.
All right. So, several years ago, it was about my daughter's birthday, which is in September, and I got really, really sick. And I mean, lots of medication, down, barely cognitive of the environment around me.
Right.
And my wife and I were talking while I was in this haze, and I made a prediction. I said, December, I think it was 18th, that's the first day it's going to snow. So, at least 3 months out. And so we wrote it down on the calendar.
Mm-hmm.
Like, well, you know, if it happens, wow, that'd be weird. As the date approached, you know, much anxiety. Is it going to happen? No snow yet? No snow yet? That day, that morning, it started snowing.
Hmm. Well, you know, that's once. So it could be a happy coincidence, or you could have mental powers.
Hey, let's not.
No, I'm serious. So obviously you're going to try again, right?
Well, I'm not saying that nothing like that hasn't happened before and it won't happen again, but that was one of the more spectacular ones.
Okay. Well, all I can say is keep trying. You know, it is spectacular, and if you can really predict events and you see something awful coming, call us right away.
You bet.
All right. Thank you very much for the call. Let's go to the time traveler line and say you are on the air. Hello.
Hello?
Yes, hello.
Hi, this is Rich. I'm in southern New Mexico.
Hi, Rich. That's very fortunate. Almost a local call for you. You're coming in on a... yeah, I see you are in New Mexico. How about that? You're coming in on our Roswell time traveler line, so I presume you are a time traveler, right?
Well, I don't know for sure. I think I had at least time warp experience that was pretty interesting.
Okay, I'm not sure if warp is the same as traveler, but I guess you could be an inadvertent traveler, kind of, right?
Right. This has only happened to me one time, but okay. It was pretty impressive.
All right, tell me about it.
Okay, I got out of the Marines in 1971 and went back to the University of New Mexico and worked on a couple of archaeological field schools as a photographer, and had been a geology major and decided to switch to anthro and was taking archaeology classes. And one of my professors said, hey, if you would like to take a couple semesters off, I've got a job for you with the Museum of New Mexico doing survey work. So I dropped out of school, went up to Santa Fe, and ended up on a survey of a coal mining lease up near Farmington. It was the San Juan Power Plant eventually. It's right across the river from the Four Corners Power Plant.
Okay.
But the lease was about 2 miles wide, about 8 miles long, and it took us two guys several weeks to survey the whole thing. We were doing this on foot.
Okay, we don't have a lot of time here, so we've got to kind of get to the center of the story.
Well, the guy I was working with was kind of a loose cannon, and I decided to just camp out on the lease rather than go into town with him at night.
Right.
It was getting pretty dangerous. So one night I was sleeping in my tent. There was a full moon, and I heard all of this singing, drum beats, and off about maybe a quarter mile or less, I could see a big campfire, and it was up against a cliff face, and I could see shadows of people dancing, and I could even see people up on the top of the ridge in the moonlight. This went on for 2-3 hours. And at that time of year, the Navajo people have a nighttime ceremony. It's called a squaw dance, and it's sort of Sadie Hawkins. The girls ask the boys to dance, and you're in trouble if you say no. Anyway, I guess 2 or 3 in the morning, maybe, things quieted down. Well, the next morning, my partner hadn't shown up yet. He was frequently late, and so I decided to hike over and take a look at what was going on the night before.
Okay, the story has to end pretty quick because the clock is...
Okay, well, all right, well, there was no tracks, no nothing, and I was standing on an Anasazi ruin from about 1050 AD.
Wow.
Yeah, wow.
So you began looking around for anybody from, you know, now, right?
Right, right, and the soil there was a kind of a compacted shale mostly. Shows tracks real well, you know.
So it's like you got thrown into the past, huh?
Yes, and I mean it was vivid. I was
okay. Such short time. For how long did you remain there?
That particular morning, or
that particular time? Yes. Or did were you there for days and days, or months, or years, or what?
No, just a few hours.
A few hours. And how did you snap out of it?
Just walked back to my tent. And that was the end of it.
So your tent was right where it was supposed to be.
Yes.
A category. Now, there's no way to know if we're really talking to a time traveler or not. But in all seriousness, I do think that time travel either is happening now, people can actually travel in time, or will be able to travel in time. And when you talk to people like this and you question them about, you know, when they are and what's going on then, whenever then is, you get some interesting answers. And, of course, you can sort of write it down. And if you're still alive when that year comes, I'm still bothered by this cell phones get thicker thing. That just can't be. I would go with the fellow who said implants, right? On Skype, it's... how do I pronounce your name?
Trisha.
Trisha. It is Trisha. T-Y-S-H-A. That's unusual. Very unusual.
Absolutely. It's very nice to talk to you. My husband's been a fan for many, many years.
Well, hello there to your husband. Okay, you probably have a device on in the background. That will confuse you mightily. You need to turn it off, or you won't make sense.
Let me try. Yeah, I don't know what device I have on. It's the headphones, probably.
Yeah, it'll really confuse you. It's like 30 seconds in the past. It's like time travel.
Can you hear me okay now?
I can, but it's going to confuse you.
I hear you. I understand what you're saying.
Yeah.
Okay, so I know that you did the ghost to ghost on the coast to coast, and I have kind of a creepy story.
Okay.
It's kind of a short and...
Okay, you've still got it on, don't you? You're not going to make sense as long as you have that on in the background.
I need you to...
Yeah, it's going to confuse you, I'm telling you. Now it's even louder.
Okay, can you hear me okay?
No, now I'm hearing myself. Okay, we're going to have to terminate this. Let that... I'm sorry we missed your creepy story, Trisha, but here's the deal. Because of, the delay between here and you, it amounts to about 30 seconds. So if you leave your device, whatever your device is, on in the background, you are going to sound so confused. You're never going to be able to tell a story. You're never going to be able to sound like you know what you're talking about, because you can't help yourself. I'm no different. Trust me. If I began to hear myself 30 seconds ago, I would probably come to a dead stop. I couldn't handle it. So when you actually get on the air, you've got to turn that off immediately. You've got to be prepared to turn it off immediately. We have a time traveler. Hello there. You are on Midnight.
Hello there, Mr. Bell. How are you tonight?
I'm doing okay, sir.
Well, I'm a time traveler, and I must say I've been listening for a while, and a lot of these guys, when you ask them about the science, it's kind of interesting because none of them can really answer the science behind it.
But I do understand why that could be. If they were to actually give away the kind of science that they would have to give away to satisfy me, they might cause some sort of terrible ripple effect in time, because we could suddenly make a machine. So, but nevertheless, if you are going to give us the science, then go ahead.
Well, here's the deal. Here's how this works. Okay, are you familiar with the spooky action at a distance?
Yes.
Okay. Now,
quantum entanglement.
Yes, yes, yes. Now, back in the year, well, several years from now, and I might inspire the young scientist that comes up with this, we launch a probe to the sun, and we throw some particles up at the sun, and those particles instantaneously charge our batteries, or what you could call like a battery. It's an infinite battery source, okay? Now, here's the biggest problem is you've got to phase gravity, okay? And that's the biggest thing with time travelers, phasing gravity. And see, anybody who says there's a time traveler out there that doesn't understand the science, they're crazy because, you know, we come back, we get seeds all the time because there's a lot of things that don't grow right since all the DNA crap that they did to the plants. So, you know, people are getting allergic to all this stuff. Even starting now, you're starting to see some of that.
But, a lot of allergies, you know, this year in the desert. Listen, what year have you traveled to or from?
Well, I'm more like a 2040. We're a group of people that collect seeds, and just by me collecting those seeds throws me into a different quantum, which you could say a different timeline. At least that's the easiest way you could describe it. You know, Back to the Future is funny. You know, we play clips of that, but, you know, it couldn't be. I mean, you got to remember, I mean, you're changing, you're warping, you're phasing space and time around you. And you got to have an endless amount of power, and the only place you can do that is through the sun. And the interesting part in this, I'll leave you with this.
Yes. Don't leave me yet. First of all, I want to know why you need the seeds. It bodes.
Well, you see, history repeats itself just through different things. So
yes,
like
it does.
Cigarettes, so, like, you had the big evil cigarette companies. Now you got the big evil. You know, this time it's the people that are going to mess this up for at least a good 60 years.
Oh,
and that's getting rid of the crap that's in all the plants. And see, the plants, when they grow, you know, you got these bees that pollinate. And when these bees are pollinating, these things are going and buzzing around and doing the things that they're supposed to be doing. But, you know, all these chemicals are medically changing them. They're medically changing the plants. And then you wind up, you see, DNA is a 4-bit code, okay? It's not like a computer. Computers today, when you guys think you got it figured out, you're crazy. It's 4 bits, okay? And with DNA being 4 bits, you start monkeying with that. Next thing you know, you got to come back, you got to get the original thing. And good luck. You know, good heavens, thank the Lord we got time.
So
now,
are you telling me that you're here to get seeds or to carry seeds?
Yeah, we do it all the time. We burn entire crops that get contaminated still.
Right.
So I mean, we don't want to mess with the bees anymore, because if you mess with the bees, and the bees will carry that pollen, so you can't kill the bees. So you got to kill crops, and that's the only way you can keep containment. I mean, that's the sad part. And majority of what you have in the future because of the food crisis is nothing but farmers.
How far in the future have you gone?
Well, I don't go into the future. We more or less are concerned with current day survival of our families. I mean, if you've got kids and you got families, you understand immediately you're interested in that. There's some people that have, but to do a future event versus a past event's much harder, because, you know, wherever you're going to materialize, as they call it,
Yes.
You gotta remember, if you don't know where you're going, you can wind up in the middle of something. That'd be like in the middle of that ship. What was the name of that ship that was out there? What was that? Not Manhattan, but there's some ship that they were playing with gravity and they got it all monkeyed up and men were in the...
I think you may be talking about the Philadelphia experiment.
There you go. You got the nail right on the head there, Sonny. Okay,
good. Good, good, good. All right, well, listen, I truly appreciate your call. I do understand that seeds in time could be a very, very important commodity, right? If you need seeds, well, that means something pretty dire has occurred. Let's go to, how about Ray? Ray, you're on the air on Skype, I hope.
Good morning, sir.
Hi, Ray. Where are you?
I am in Akron, Ohio.
Akron, Ohio. Good.
And years ago, I was a board op for one of your affiliates.
Really?
Yes, sir. You and I spent a lot of nights together.
Yes, sir. A board op is... Well, Ray, I don't know if you're watching me right now. I'm on Periscope, so people can see. But I kind of do everything. You know, I answer the phones. I take care of the music and the raw stuff and the telephones and, my goodness, everything.
Well, I am totally blind, so I won't be watching you.
Wow. Okay,
now,
I'm very sorry.
I'll tell you two reasons why I called.
Okay, Ray, but before that, how were you able to be a board op, if you don't mind my asking?
Well, radio is primarily an aural medium.
Oh, yes.
And back in the bad old days, we had proper analog meters.
That's true.
It was really easy to tell when the pin was getting banged.
Okay. All right. You said you had a couple things.
I do. You actually let off my webcast on Friday evening.
I did?
Oh, yes, but in a rather unusual way.
How did I do it?
Oh, you snored on 3840.
It wasn't me that did that.
Actually, wait a minute.
I know who that was. That was a friend of mine named Ben. And one night he fell asleep on the microphone, keyed it, and snored on 3840.
Yeah, but your identifier went off and everybody thought it was you.
That may well be, but it wasn't me. It was Ben. Trust me, it was Ben, buddy. And he snored for a long time. You know what? We had to end up calling his mother and... having her wake him up, it was a little embarrassing.
Well, it was great fun for everybody that listened to the webcast on Friday evening, regardless of who did it.
Yeah. Okay,
what else?
Other
thing.
Yes.
You had Ed Danes on years ago.
Uh-huh.
And as someone who is totally blind, I was very curious how he was able to teach or train totally blind people to remote view. Is there any possibility that you might get him again?
Well, there's always a possibility, but the guy owes me gold, and it's never showed up. And until the gold gets here, I'm not sure Ed will.
Well, you might have to talk to his leprechaun about that.
All right. Well, listen.
Good morning, Art.
Good morning.
What's your calling for? Richard calling from Northern Ireland.
Northern Ireland. Hi, Richard. What a wonderful place it must be.
Fantastic, Art. Fantastic. But good to hear you back, my friend. I've been listening to you in various ways from 1996.
Wow. Well, it's great to have you here. What's on your mind?
Well, I want to tell you a story, and I'm not sure if it's a time travel story or not, but I will tell you this story.
Okay.
Back in the 80s, late 70s, I was earning probably more money than I should. I'm now 57 than for a person of my age.
Mm-hmm.
So I was in the bar one night, being the center of attraction, and I was at the bar.
Probably buying everybody drinks, huh?
Buying everyone drinks, everyone in the bar. And a guy slapped me in the back of the head, and I won't say it because I know children listen to the show, but he said the A-H word.
Mm-hmm.
Hit me in the back of the ward and ran out the door. Well, my hackles got up, Art, and I ran after this guy and what I was going to do to him. And I ran, but no matter how hard I ran, Art, I couldn't catch this guy. And at the very end of the block, two blocks up, he turned around and he looked at me. And this guy had white hair and black glasses. Now, I was in my 20s. I had bright red hair. But there was a familiarity about this guy.
So in other words, he was old and frail, and you were young and fast, and you couldn't catch him.
Couldn't catch him.
Now, how much joy had you consumed before you tried?
Oh, a lot of joy, Art.
Yes.
A lot of joy.
I see.
But I'm now 57, Art, and I now have pure white hair and black rim glasses.
Oh, good Lord, you chased yourself.
Exactly. And I don't know if it was the subconscious or a warning or just something from the future warning me about my behavior.
Wow. Well, when you looked at yourself in that moment, were you able... Did you know that you were looking at yourself?
I knew there was a familiarity, or what threw me was the white hair and the black glasses. I never imagined myself ever having that look. But now looking in the mirror, I know exactly who it was.
Oh, my God. What an experience.
So right there.
And so now you... At how old are you now? You're
57.
So you now look the exact image of what you recall.
The exact image of the person that I chased that night.
All right. Well, joy aside, that's quite a story, my friend. Thank you so very much.
Good to hear you, Art. Thank you.
Good one. Good one. All the way from Ireland. Wow. Can you imagine that? You're out there, you know, after a little altercation, so to speak, and you're chasing somebody, and you, of course, don't catch them, but you get a really good look, and you realize you're looking at yourself. Man, that is just plain freaky. I don't know what else to call it. Brandon on Skype, you're on the air. Hello.
Hi, Art. How are you?
That was quite a story he just told. I'm fine.
I want to know what's going on with Madman Markham.
Okay. Here's the deal. Madman is still around, alive, that is to say. I actually called him probably now a month ago, and he is preparing a warehouse for a gigantic time machine. And so he's going to have a lot more power, a lot more voltage, and he's probably going to kill himself, to be honest with you. But that, and so that's all I know. I'm free to call him, you know, pick a night, and I probably will call him and find out what's going on.
Awesome. Didn't he do jail time?
Well, he did. I forget. Did he do jail time? I think he might have done a little. And, of course, I talked to his arresting officer, so the whole story was absolutely true. Yeah, he had a pretty serious brush with the law.
Okay, well, I just want to wish you Roswells and say hello to my wife, Christine, and I wish you a good night.
All right. Good night, Christine. Take care, and thank you very much for the call. Yeah, he's okay for now. How long that's going to last, I really, truly don't know. Let's see, do I need to do a break or did I already do it? I'm getting so wrapped up in these stories. Let's go to our time traveler line and say, hello there, you're on Midnight and you're going to have to turn off your device.
Hello, Mr. Bell.
Hello, sir.
Yes, I'm a time traveler.
And from what year are you? I hear myself coming back. That's not a good sign.
I'm very sorry. Give me just a moment here. Let me turn off my device.
Yes.
I'm very sorry, sir.
It's all right.
Okay, it's off.
Okay, so what year are you from? Still got that.
It varies.
It varies?
It varies.
In other words, you can go where you want to go.
It's not my choice.
It's not?
I am a
the children with black eyes. Now, that's something that was brought up by a lady caller not long ago. Did you happen to hear that?
No, sir.
And what do the children with black eyes make you do?
I have black eyes myself now. And they force me to travel and to do this to other people. It is very distressing.
You sound distressed.
Every time that it happens to me, I lose a little bit of who I used to be, Mr. Bell. Every time they force me to time travel, I lose a little bit of myself.
You sound very distressed, actually.
I need to warn your listeners, do not answer for these children with black eyes. They are real, Mr. Bell. They are very real. And they will take you. They will not kill you, but they will make you disappear. Your soul, Mr. Bell.
My soul.
Will be gone. They will take your soul. They force me to travel in time, back, forth, back and forth.
How much time are you covering?
Mr. Bell, it varies. I've been in the future hundreds of years. I've been back hundreds of years. You know,
I can't really determine if you're laughing or you're crying or both.
It's a little bit of both. I miss my family, Mr. Bell.
Yeah, I bet you do.
I've had a wife. I had children. But I'm lost to time.
So you've lost them all?
I've lost them all. And I can't even remember what they look like, Mr. Bell, because when I close my eyes, all I see is these children.
God.
Staring at me soullessly, forcing me to do their bidding, Mr. Bell.
Is it your feeling that they actually don't have souls?
They used to. They're like you and me, Mr. Bell. Only they fell victim to those who came before them.
I hope my soul's still intact. And
I hope so too, Mr. Bell.
All right.
I can feel your energy, Mr. Bell. You're a good man.
Energy I've got. That's right. All right. Well, listen, thank you very, very much. I appreciate it. That's kind of chilling. I don't know how to take that as a joke or as something dead serious. Let's go to Seattle, Washington. You're on the air. Hi.
Oh, hi.
Hi.
I just turned off my device. Hi.
Bless you.
Hey, real quick, because I know we're still on time. I had a couple of questions about an older show. I like a good UFO story. I like the ones that are more verifiable and realistic.
What do you consider to be verifiable when it comes to UFOs?
Believable people, like the one triangle story. It was a good one. I like that.
It was verified actually by the newspaper. Yeah. So many people said, we live in a day and age, sir, when you really can't trust any photograph. I mean, everything
exactly.
can be jimmied. Even video can be
exactly.
cooked up. So I wonder how you.
Yeah. The most important one, I think, is the Phoenix Lights.
I agree.
It was seen by so many people.
I agree.
It was photographed somewhat, you know. Now, I remember when that happened and listening to your show, and there's two stories I've been trying to go back and find. I went through all my old cassette tapes, which I couldn't find the story. And I swear there was somebody in a private plane that called in.
Oh, yes.
That was under the craft or above the craft?
Actually, I believe that I had somebody call on a private airplane that went into Area 51. Is that what you're recalling?
No. The Phoenix Lights.
The Phoenix Light. Well, no, there was no light aircraft that I'm aware of. Not that I'm aware of, sir.
Okay, and then there was a second one I thought was from the Phoenix Light story of somebody at an Air Force base that said they removed the gun camera footage from an Air Force plane that went after that craft at Phoenix that night.
Really?
And I'm wondering if any of your listeners remember that, or if you might recall that. Or
we've got it, all right. Hello there in, well, I don't know where you are. You're on the air. Hi.
Hello.
Hello. Extinguish your device right away.
Yes, I'm extinguishing immediately. Hey, Art, this is Eagle in Hollywood. I talked to you way back in the 90s. How have you been?
Fine. Hollywood, California.
Hollywood, California, yes.
Hollywood, California, okay.
I talked to you about the Pleiadians back in the 90s, and you were like, oh, that guy did his homework and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, okay.
Back in the day, but...
You're really a Hollywood resident. Can you tell me how many times has the Hollywood sign been destroyed in motion pictures?
Oh, God, really? You really want me to get into that?
I was just curious.
Come on. That goes back to the 60s with that bank building that got destroyed in the earthquake or whatever, that whatever bank building next to that whatever bank building. But, yeah, I know my topography pretty well around here.
All right.
Up here.
Okay.
But, yes. Wow. Okay.
Wow, okay.
First of all, I got two questions. I have two questions for you, and then I will let everybody else get in, because I know it's like a madhouse.
It is. Go ahead. Questions. Number one, please.
Number one is, have you ever heard of a person named Freeman Fly before?
No.
The Freeman perspective. He's a pretty interesting guy. You might want to look into interviewing that guy.
All right. Question number two.
Question number two is, this whole deal with ISIS trying to attack the pyramids and Sphinx. And
well, no, they haven't said they're going to do that. I had somebody on very concerned with Egypt. The whole Arab Spring is going on. So I did ask, of course, if he was concerned about that possibility. And I think it's a real possibility, I'm afraid.
It's because it's so scary because you know about, back a long time back, there was some research done. I don't know if it's true or not, but there was some radioactive sand found under the Great Pyramid somewhere in some chamber area. And like, what if there's something there? If it got detonated, they blew
detonated?
It up.
Detonated? Oh.
Could it cause harm? Could there be something radioactive in it?
Yeah, that'd be bad. There's absolutely no question about it. We're way short on time. I don't know what happened to the show. It's, what, 11:40 Pacific now, and I don't know what's happened at the time. Hello, Brandon. You're on the air. Brandon? Maybe not. Do I have it up? Yes, I do. Everything's right. Brandon's not there. Fine. We'll go to... let me see. How about Scott? Scott, you're on Skype and you're on the air.
Hi, Art. Can you hear me okay?
I hear you, yes.
Good. About an hour ago, did you ask for me and I wasn't there or something?
I think it's possible, yes.
All right, well, okay. Either that or we're having the same deja vu. last night, your guest, Nason, was talking about the persistence of historical information about past people, events, their consciousness, etc.
That's right.
And he said it may require using a supercomputer to gain access to it. Now, I wanted to comment about...
Actually, it was me, and I said it may require a quantum computer.
Okay. Well, here's the deal. In 1986, I had a personal experience using no equipment at all that emulated that type of retrieval of information. And if you have a couple of minutes, I'll tell you about it.
About a couple minutes is all I've got.
Okay. I got married in early 86. My wife's new wedding ring did not fit right, so while it was being resized, she wore a ring that was owned by her grandmother, her mother's mother, and it had little stones representing her mother's siblings.
Mm-hmm.
And I was telling her about some classes I took with a psychic where you hold an object and go with whatever impressions you get. And she said, can you do that? I said, sure. She said, we'll do it with this. I went on to describe events, places, people, none of which I'd ever heard of or places I'd ever been to.
Wow.
Regarding buildings and a piano that was turned backwards.
Now, wait, is this just knowledge you had? Is it something you visualized? What?
Not at all. These are people and events and places that I'd never been to or had never heard of, ever. And as it turned out, I visualized one thing was an old building up on stones. And it turned out to be a little country store in southwest Missouri that my wife and her siblings went to when they visited their grandmother as children. I had another impression of a piano, an upright piano with sadness attached to it, also a little bucket with a brick on it and a chain. That turned out to be her mother's, one of her young siblings as a child, was very was a natural talent at playing the piano. He got into a bucket in which they kept rat poison, ate it, got sick, and died.
Okay.
Well, wait a minute. It gets better.
Okay.
The mother was so distraught. My former mother-in-law's mother was so distraught at the death of her child who played the piano that she ordered the piano be put on the back porch facing so that no one could get access to the keyboard because it would only remind her of her dead child.
Mm-hmm.
Now, my wife and I, there were several other things. Long story
short. Okay, I don't have several other things, or time for several other things, so.
Okay, but.
Long story has to be
real
short.
The hair on her head was standing up. Mine was standing up. I have no idea how I do it other than I've done it dozens of times.
Well, okay, thank you. Look, people do have powers. Does anybody actually doubt that? I certainly don't. People have powers that are completely inexplicable by science. Whether it's precognition, whether it's the ability to traverse time in some way, these things are real. They really do happen. Try and explain them to somebody, you know, like a police officer, and, you know, you're going to end up probably with the guys with the white coats, right? But these things really happen. I guess that's one of the reasons we have a... If there were not things that happen that you cannot prove with science, that you cannot nail down by holding on to it, knowing it's true, if there were not things that you had to take on faith, there wouldn't be a reason to do a program like this one, would there? Let's go to Mountain Home, Idaho. Hello. You're on the air.
Yes, Art.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Your sound quality is just superb.
Isn't it? Thank you. Oh, that reminds me, let me just take one moment before you continue. It is superb. And listen, folks, trust me on this. If you're not using them, get a set of earbuds from Bob Crane. I'm so serious about this. He's got these new form-fitting earbuds from Bob Crane at the C. Crane Company. And listen to the program in stereo. It'll blow your mind. And I'm sorry, I had to do that. Go ahead.
No, I understand. Well, most of my questions have been answered, except, and I'm really pleased you're going to do Halloween show again.
Of course.
And can you get the Ghostbuster gals back on?
Of course.
Oh, they're so wonderful.
Yes, yes. And I'll tell you who else we're going to get on is Barbara and Brandon, Brendan and Barbara from the GIS.
Oh, okay.
How about that?
I remember that.
Electronic.
The other thing I was wondering.
Electronic is, voice phenomena.
How long do you think it's going to take for JC to find you?
I don't know. I'm sure he's calling now. You know, every phone line is busy every minute of every hour. So JC will eventually get in.
The show started.
Yeah, he'll eventually get in.
Oh, that's true. Just everybody be persistent. you take care. Sounds like you're having fun.
Yeah, I am having fun. Thank you very much. Take care.
Bye-bye.
Right. Going to Sydney, NS. What is that? Nova Scotia or what?
It is Nova Scotia.
Really?
It is, yes.
Hi, Sydney. How are you doing?
I'm so happy that you're back.
Thank you.
Sorry, I'm going to fangirl out for a second, Roswells. Over the moon, you're back. A few quick comments. I know that you don't have a lot of time. There was a guy that used to live on the side of a mountain in Hawaii, and he used to take a drug that brought him inside a spaceship.
Yes.
What happened to him? Can you ever have him back? Are you guys still friends? What's going on with him?
Do you remember the name?
No, he was Timothy Leary's apprentice, and I was looking for it earlier. I can't find his name.
Timothy Leary.
Do you remember who I mean?
I don't really. Timothy Leary's apprentice. So this was reality versus something that Timothy gave his apprentice. That was a joke.
Sorry, what do you mean? He gave what? His apprentice what?
That was a joke. I said this was reality you're describing versus something that Timothy gave to his apprentice? You don't get it. That's
it
all right.
A little bit of both. No, sorry.
I'm not.
Do you know who I mean, though?
No, I really don't. I'm sorry.
Yeah, and he lived in I think you talked to him a few times. He lived in Hawaii, like on a volcano.
On a boat.
And
are you talking? Wait. Are you talking about Terrence McKenna?
Yes, I am. Yes, I am.
All right. Terrence Hunt has passed away.
I am so sorry to hear that. I thought he was sick, but I wasn't sure. I know Father Malachi had passed.
Yes, he has.
And I wasn't sure. Oh, I'm so sorry to hear that.
Oh, that's...
Oh, he was fascinating, yeah.
Terrence was amazing, actually.
Yeah. Oh, brilliant. Just blew my mind, yeah. And he just seemed like the kind of guy you want to be friends with. Just down to earth, just nice, just such a nice perspective of life. I wish there were more people like him. Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, you're absolutely right on every count. Thank you very much for the call.
Oh, two quick questions.
Yes.
I like stuff on prophecies, if you ever have stuff like that, like Nostradamus, stuff like that.
Okay.
And I liked, well, I also liked hearing about your family and stuff and your cats, obviously. and a time traveler you had on once, I think he said it the best. He said, you can't travel back in time further than the invention of the first time machine.
Right.
And once that happens, people are just going to start appearing out of nowhere. And I think of them as like phone booths in my mind that they're just going to be popping up everywhere. And could you imagine, really, if that happened, say, tomorrow?
I can.
Middle of the afternoon?
Yes. Oh, yes.
Oh, really?
Yes. Oh. My time traveler line is ringing off the hook, and you just never
know.
You never know.
I know.
All right. Thank you very much for the call, and have a good night. Now comes somebody that calls himself Zenoff the Alien. Is that right?
Art Bell, how dare you? No, I'm just kidding.
Not quite good enough, buddy, but good try.
Yeah. Hey, I love your clock, man.
Oh, thank you. I love it, too. You know this clock. I'll tell you about this clock. I went to Radio France Internationale in Paris as a visitor, a special visitor, and I went into their studio, and I saw this clock. And I damn near ripped it off the wall. I wanted it so badly. I had never seen a clock like it in my life. So I came back to the U.S. I searched like a madman for this clock until I finally found it. I now own three of them.
That's madness.
Pardon me? Hello?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, it sounds like you're covering up the mic.
Oh, no, sorry, my finger must have been on it.
Yeah.
Anyway. Can you bring back the weird caller line sometime?
Of course I can.
Sweet.
Actually, for the most part, I can answer any line and expect that.
Well, this is true. I would also like to hear Adam Kokesh on your show sometime.
I'll put it on the list.
All right.
Okay. Thank you very, very much for the call. Have, Saskatchewan. Is it Yorkton, Saskatchewan? Or is it SK? I can't figure it out.
It's Saskatchewan. You're absolutely right on that.
All right. Well, hello.
I know you got a short time before you're done.
It's true.
I just want to welcome you back to the air and let you know that you were actually my influence when I was younger. to get into radio, and I wanted to thank you for that. So,
you're actually professionally in radio now?
Yes, I've been in for 13 years. I used to listen to you high school, when I was in high school, my final year, got the radio bug. Thanks.
And so let me guess, you're ready for retirement now, right?
I wish. There's no money in radio, but it's fun, though.
These people who call up like you and say, you know, I've known you since I was 3. I was listening on the radio with my mom, and now I'm 50.
Oh, I'm not that old.
Makes me feel old. Anyway, what's on your mind, sir?
Well, I was just going to share with you, there was one time that I was driving home from a friend's place, taking the same route, and it's usually a 5-minute drive, and then I lost, and I went back to my house, and it was 3 hours later, and I still, to this day, don't know what happened.
Oh, that happens to a lot of people. It's kind of like a time slip. It does happen, and I'm not sure what causes it. I've had little ones myself, but, you know, 3 hours, suddenly, like that, bad.
Yeah, it's kind of scary.
It's frightening. Like, it's extremely, of course it's scary. What happened during that time?
And then you watch that thing Fire in the Sky with Travis Walton and stuff like that. Makes you wonder if it happened to you, but you don't have any memories, and you're like,
you should, have you ever heard Travis Walton interviewed?
Yes, I've heard him on your show. That was amazing.
Yeah.
My dad and I used to listen to that. We actually listened to the archives before you came back and count down time till he came back. So
sure. I should interview Travis again. Now, his story doesn't change, you know, so it's something that you'll just hear again. But it is such a believable story.
Exactly. I have a recommendation for you there, Art, if you got a couple seconds.
Just a couple.
Dan Aykroyd. Yeah,
Aykroyd. I know Dan is really interested in the paranormal genre.
Yes.
I think he attempted a show of his own, didn't he, at one point?
I believe he did, and he also has this Crystal Head vodka that he made in the Crystal Skull. You know how there's those Crystal Skulls that are supposedly out there?
Yeah.
Pretty cool.
Right, well, if you got to drink vodka from a Crystal Skull, I guess, way to do it. All right, I got to go.
That's right.
Right, thank
you.
Have
a good one, Art.
Right, you too. Bye-bye. Midnight.